So in the last class, we completed till the fate of princely states. I just introduced the revision for that. And I also discussed about the government's approach, how government tried to integrate the princely states. So we had to start with three important integration, that is Hyderabad, Manipur, and Junagadh. Now, Junagadh was integrated through plebiscite, right? Then comes Hyderabad. What happened in Hyderabad? Now, in a quick key points I have mentioned here, but just let's discuss that. So first of all, Nizam of Hyderabad was the richest man. Okay, he wanted independent status for Hyderabad. So next point, he entered into a standstill agreement with India in November 1947 for 1 year. Okay, whereas negotiations were still going on. Okay, at that particular time only, the people of Hyderabad, they started a movement against the Nizam's rule. Which in who were those people? The people involved, the peasantry in the Telangana region in particular, they were the victim of Nizam's oppressive rule and they rose against him. There were women who had seen the worst of this oppression, right? And the communists and the Hyderabad Congress, they were in the forefront of the movement. Now, how did Nizam responded? Nizam responded by leaving a paramilitary force known as Razakars on the people. Now, the atrocities was boundless. And that is why the government of India ordered the Indian army to intervene. Then you see the entry of the Indian army, which finally made the Nizam surrender. So the surrender, when Nizam surrendered, that led to the Hyderabad's accession to India. Okay, next is the case of Manipur. What happened in Manipur was a few days just before independence, Maharaja of Manipur, that is Bodh Chandra Singh, he signed the instrument of accession with the Indian government on the assurance that they will be given internal autonomy. So the internal autonomy of Manipur will be maintained. Now, under the pressure of people, Maharaja held elections and the state became a constitutional monarchy. Okay, but Manipur for the first time was a part of India to hold an election based on universal adult franchise. Now, when you start an election, when the leader has come with proper elections, then you have to listen to the legislative assembly as well. You must consider their opinions. But what happened here was the legislative assembly of Manipur had sharp differences over the question of merger of Manipur with India. Whereas the state congress wanted the merger, even the other political parties were opposed to this. So the government of India finally pressurized the Maharaja for signing the merger agreement in September without consulting the popularly elected legislative assembly. And that is why there were disturbances, there were anger. Okay? Coming to Andhra Pradesh, what happened in Andhra Pradesh? How did the issue of language started? Now see, the process of nation building came up and the leaders, they started drawing the international boundaries in a way so that linguistic and cultural plurality of the country should be given importance. They started recognizing the cultural plurality of the country. Okay, now during the colonial rule, the state boundaries were drawn on administrative convenience. Whichever area was convenient for the Britishers, they started, marking the boundaries as per their convenience. Okay, but here we have to create a nation. Our challenge was nation building. So the leaders were having a pressure as to how to create a nation so that it doesn't become a problem for the unity of India. Right. So they started creating states on the basis of language. They started recognizing the language. Okay, so what happened was language was seen as one basis. Earlier, the leaders were little hesitant in order to create this division on the basis of language, in order to create states, sorry, not division. So states on the basis of language, because they thought that it would rather hamper the unity of the country. It was felt that this would draw the attention away from other socio-economic challenges that the country faced. The central leadership decided to postpone the matters. Okay, the need for postponement was also felt because the fate of princely states were not decided, the memory of partition was fresh. So there were more negative points. But the decision of national leadership was challenged by the local leaders. Protests started coming up in the Telugu-speaking areas of Madras, which includes present-day Tamil Nadu, parts of Andhra Pradesh. There, Vishal Andhra movement started. That is the separate movement for Andhra Pradesh. It demanded that Telugu-speaking areas should be separated from Madras, of which they were a part, and that should be made into a separate Andhra province. Okay, so Vishal Andhra movement was there to create Andhra Pradesh for Telugu-speaking people. Now, here comes another very important person, Pothi Sriramulu. Okay. That person went on too fast. Fast, and that fast led to the death. Now, one, when somebody dies on too for your demands, for your concern, then naturally that will create outbursts. Now, the death of this person, great person for them, for the Vishal Andhra movement. People started coming onto streets. There were violent outbursts. Many were injured, many lost their lives, and police in the police firing. And in Madras, several legislators they resigned their seats in the protest. And finally, the Prime Minister announced the formation of a separate Andhra in 1952. Now, when this happened, the effects of that is a formation of Andhra Pradesh started the struggle, gave a reason for struggle for making of other states also on linguistic lines in other parts of the country. These struggles therefore forced the government to create which commission? States Reorganization Commission in 1953 to look into the question of redrawing of the boundaries of the states. And the commission accepted that boundaries of the state should reflect the boundaries of different languages. And on the basis of the report, State Reorganization Act was passed in 1956, which further led to the creation of 14 states and 6 union territories. Okay? So, what were the results of creating the linguistic states? Now, one of the most important results of creating the linguistic states was the demand for separate states. Now, when the demand for separate states come, that means there will be demand for separatism that is harmful for the unity of the nation. When every state will start recognizing themselves with a sense of language, then there will be more of separatism. They'll start separating themselves from nation and they will start recognizing themselves as a state. That was the concern. Okay, but what happened was the leadership, under popular pressure, finally made a choice in favor of linguistic states. Right? Now, what were the hopes? The hopes were that division and separatism might get reduced. Why? Because the people will understand that the government is working for them. The government is addressing their concerns. The government is addressing their demands. The government is giving importance to the state's autonomy, right? Which will foster a belief, a confidence, faith in the government, which might retain the unity of the nation. Every coin has two sides, right? So as we see that there were dangers also, but this danger coin can have a positive outlook as well, right? So therefore, it was thought that accommodation, there will be better accommodation of regional demands, and that is why the formation of linguistic states was seen as more democratic. And that is what that happened. The result that was seen with the creation of linguistic states was that after years of independence, it was realized that linguistic states and the movement for the formation of these states changed the nature of democratic politics and leadership. The path to politics power were open to people. People can participate no matter which state they belong to, which region they belong to. Okay, therefore it provided them a uniform basis to the drawing of state boundaries. It did not lead to disintegration of the country as the fear was over here. Rather, it fostered unity. People understood that fine, they live on a soil where there is immense diversity. They might be united, they might be same as a region, but they are united with diversity under one flag, under one roof, which addresses their demands, which addresses their concerns. So even they have a liability towards the state, towards the country. Okay, and that is why on the whole, India adopted democracy. It meant that India embraced a democratic constitution, not just about a format of elections. Okay, the choice was much larger. The choice was about recognizing the differences, which can be oppositional but can be constructive too. Okay, and that is how democracy was accepted as the plurality. It was associated with plurality of such ideas and ways of life. Okay, students, now this brings me to the end of chapter number one of Indian politics, that is challenges of nation building, as well as your portion for this upcoming test. So you have the Cold War era, the end of bipolarity, and the challenges of nation building. Okay, you do not have to study for this upcoming test for about US or Arab Spring, which I was teaching. Okay, you have to just study these three chapters as given in your book. Okay, again and again, I'm repeating, it's the Cold War era, it's the end of bipolarity, and the challenges of nation building. Okay, so prepare well. If any word, any sentence you have a problem with, let me know. Okay, all the very best, students. Do well. Thank you.